for gluing. So you have the rib structure against that, you glue the back, and against that, you glue the top. This is high glue, and it is in a crystal form, comes in different strengths, but this is the glue of choice for assembling violins. You don't want to use anything other than this. And obviously, you dilute it in water, it becomes like a gel, like a real jelly, and you put it into a glue pot, which we didn't bring, but you put it into like a heating element, so that, and it has to be a, we sound like maniacs to it has to be at 140 degrees, which is true. It's like,
you have to be nice to do this, you know, there's no other way.
Yeah, I'm realizing it's hard to describe, but anyway, yeah, it has to be at 140 degrees to use it. To be able to, you know, reach its full strength. And you only have 2 minutes of working time to assemble everything. It's not like tight bond, Elmer's glue, you know, where you can kind of play around with it for a little while. After 10 minutes, it kind of starts to set, but you can probably still peel it apart. With this stuff, you better have your timer out the first few times you use it, because after 2 minutes, if you don't have your pieces firmly where you want them, forget about it, start over. Wow. So but the great advantage of this stuff is that it's completely reversible. So if you mess up something, let's say, you know, you're gluing.
But we never mess up.
You know, for example, I don't know, if you glue this on sideways or something, you can easily put a little knife in there and take it off, and it's completely reversible. And yet it's very, very strong once it's, you know, once it's all together.
How long should it last?
Gosh, I do repair, so I deal a lot with the old glue joints that, you know, have reached the end of their life. And I would say, you know, a good glue joint, maybe, you know, with very little climate change over its life, you might get 50 years, maybe 100, maybe if you're lucky, 100 years out of it. But usually they kind of pop open a little bit, but they don't crack. The joint will pop, the wood won't pop, you know, the wood won't crack. So anyway, this stuff is great. And if you're gonna build violins, a lot of guitar makers use this, mandolin, you know, string instrument makers use high glue. A lot of people are very intimidated by this at the same time, because it doesn't come out of the bottle. You can't just squeeze it and just rub it around and then slap it together. You know, you have to actually kind of cook it. It has to be right. So anyway, that's high glue. And so what Matt was talking about, like with putting the blocks, corner blocks, onto the rib, it's done with high glue. So, like I said, when you take this off, you can just go pop, pop with a hammer, and it pretty much pops off. If you were using super glue, tight bond, you couldn't just pop, pop, it wouldn't come off. You know, you'd have to like cut it out. You know, this is what's vibrating primarily to produce the tone of the instrument. You know, this actually vibrates. You know, if you were to look at it in a special machine. The rest of the instrument, including the neck, it's just structure. You know, it's just the strength that provides the frame, the body. So this is always a hardwood. It has to be, and it's, if you're building in the classical model, the Cremonese model, it's always maple. Always. You know, if you're a folk violin maker, you might choose whatever other hardwood that you have available. Or for the top, you might choose cypress or something like that. But if you're building, you know, an instrument that you hope will go on to play in an orchestra one day or whatever, you're going to use spruce on the top, the rest is maple. And an interesting thing came up actually before we started about this piece here. It's called the fingerboard. It's like where you play your notes. This is also a piece of wood, you know. It's black, but it's ebony wood. And so a lot of the times the pegs, you know, the pegs, which are up here, the tailpiece, the chin rest, are probably more often than not made out of ebony, same as the fingerboard. On mine, I chose rosewood, something hard, something pretty. But yeah, basically the only thing that's not wood on a normal violin is the strings. Everything else is wood, you know. If you put little tuners on your tailpiece like that, obviously those are metal, and I have a pickup on mine because I play. Band, but other than that, it's all wood, so So yeah, softwood top, the rest is hardwood. Mm-hmm.
This wood right here, I always write the date on it when I buy it, and I thought it was pretty green. I bought this in 05, and it looked to me like it was still pretty, you know, it was dense, and so I mean, it lightens up when it starts to lose moisture. Generally, after I buy wood, I always have a piece of wood, unless I know for a fact that wood is like old, really old, and you can tell by looking at it, you know, because it oxidizes like newspaper if you look at the dashboard over time, and also too, you know, where you're getting it from. So if you get it from a reputable source and they say it's old, it'll be old, you know, they're not going to really mess with you too much on that. And so the wood, you know, and so I go pretty much by grain, wood, and also on spruce, and I want the tight grain. That's what I like, is tight grain. So this right here is maple, and this is also a pretty tight grain. But I also look for wood that when you move it like that, it already looks like it's 3D, you know? There's already depth to it. And looking at how the figure is too, you know, I mean, it pretty much is consistent all the way through the board. Also, how thick it is another big thing. See that? And, you know, you can tell a piece by how heavy it is, too. American wood and European wood, you know, you can definitely tell the difference, like, immediately.
For me, wood selection is based on mostly cosmetic value. There's a lot of violin makers who are very scientific about the process and, like, measure, you know, density, like, submersive and whatever kind of solution, or, you know, put a hammer on it and test the frequency of the plate. And, you know, that's just not my personality, that's not my mind, so I'm much more kind of into the visceral, you know, like,
you look
how it looks. And,
you look at the green.
Oh, definitely, yeah. That's what I'm saying, yeah. Like, the visual to me is important.
Mm-hmm.
The scientific element of density, you know, frequency, I'm just not into that. To me, it's like, if it looks good, it is good type of thing. So what's the difference? I knew somebody was going to ask this because it's probably the most common question I get. And it's a great question. What's the difference between a fiddle and a violin? And the answer that I've chosen for the day is that a violin has strings and a fiddle has strings. So the most amazing thing about violins is that you can play them. And I mean, you can all just work into it. It's like a work of art. And then you can actually, it lives on. And it becomes something, it takes on a life of its own. You know, after you've built it, it's like, you set it free. It's very satisfying energy.